without fear.
Yeah.
You will have the whole eternity to sing.
Yeah. Okay.
There are pressing matters that pertains to our lives.
Yes, sir.
It's yet to be continued this session.
Yeah.
We are just putting an interval. May we kindly bow our heads as we pray. Gracious, kind, and loving Heavenly Father, we are coming before your throne. We want to thank you for this privilege that we can come and worship before your presence. Sinners such as we are to be invited before your throne. We pray that you can speak to us even in this moment. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm here to talk about something.
Okay.
We will call it the great controversy.
Okay.
So that we are directed. I'm going to be quick like lightning passing before you. I hope you can make sense of what we are trying to say. Mine is just to challenge you. It is to challenge you. Maybe let me read a verse first so that we are speaking in context. I want to read with those who have their Bibles with the book of Isaiah. At least I will read two verses. One in the New Testament and one in the Old Testament. Isaiah chapter 49. And I'm reading verse 24 and 25. I promise you, before I'm tempted to preach, I will have sat down. Isaiah 49, verse 24 and 25. I will read in my Bible, and it reads, here it says, "Can those already taken be taken from a mighty man himself? Or can the body or captives of the tyrant make their escape? But this is what Jehovah has said, even the body of captives of the mighty men will be taken away, and those already taken by the tyrant himself will make their escape. And against anyone contending against you, I myself shall contend, and your own sons I myself shall save." The Lord must add a blessing in the reading of his word. We are reading the book of Mark chapter 3. We'll read verse 27. Then we can summarize. Mark chapter 3 verse 27 says, "In fact, no one that has got into the house of a strong man is able to plunder his movable goods unless first he binds the strong man, and then he will plunder his house." I think at the core of the great controversy is dominion. Normally when we hear about the great controversy, we romanticize it. And we never realize that this is a real battle with lives at stake. When you read it in Revelation, it says there was war in heaven. Ne? There was war in heaven. And I want you to find your role within the bigger spectrum of things. There was war in heaven. And the devil fought, but he could not conquer. Are we together? It's like if you are playing with a ball, and then there'll be these guys who are older than you. Then the ball unfortunately will roll towards them, and then they step on it and say, "Who's coming to fetch it?" Right? So the first step is that you would look amongst yourselves to say, who is it that's going to go? If there's no one, then you look amongst yourself as a group to say, who's going, or can we go together? Then if you can't all go together, then you must find someone who is equivalent to the task, and then will go and fetch the ball for you. Am I right? So this is the scenario that the Bible pictures here. It says, there's someone, and he is strong, and he has captured us. The challenge with us, Ellen White usually say, higher than the human mind can reach is God's ideal for his children. Godliness and godlikeness. If we must go with the original intent that God has put us here for, it is that we must rule. So at the center of what gathers us here is dominion. It's rulership. And this takes the picture of religion from spirituality to the battlefield. I know that we mostly view the Bible from a spiritual point, and we forget that there is a raging battle. There's a singer who says, when the declaration was made on Calvary to say that it is finished, he says, I thought that the battle was over. Little did I know that the battle was still raging. So now the question that the Bible poses to us is to say, who is it that can go and take from the person that we say is mighty, who has captives? Now, you can't have captives if you don't have dominion. Do you agree? You can't have captives if you don't have soldiers to protect that which you have gathered as spoils. Because there must be preservation of what we have collected. Are we together? Now, there must be a challenging point that has dominion as well. Let me take you, I know that we went to Egypt sometime in the morning. Let's go back there. Israel was not captured. They found themselves in Egypt as fulfillment of prophets. Are we together? But unfortunately, circumstances turned them into being captives. So, meaning to say, now, what brought them to Egypt has changed to a point that it will take drastic measures for them to leave Egypt. There might have been a time of escape. Now, you never get independence or be liberated by pleading. Are we together, Bazalwane? When something is captured, it takes force to get it out. When God went to Egypt, now, this is the part we are going to close with, because Paul says we are God's ambassadors. Now, an ambassador is not a spiritual appointment. It's a political deployment. Are we together, Bazalwane? So, when you are an ambassador, now, if I'm a citizen, ne? And then Ushula slaps me, God forbid. We don't know what might happen thereafter. If he slaps me as a citizen of South Africa, it's an assault, agir. But if he slaps my elder, it becomes an international affair. Am I right? Elder Muzale is from Zambia. Agir. The moment something happens to him, it begins to involve international relations. Are we together? So, and as ambassador, you are a working government. You are representing your country. Are we together? You are there to negotiate bilateral decisions, to influence as well laws and their making. So when God sends Moses, he's sending him as an ambassador to say, I need you to go to talk to Pharaoh and tell him to release my children. And if he does not do that, tell him that we are going to escalate matters. If the table does not afford us an opportunity to understand each other, tell him what's going to follow is an arm struggle. I'm going to calm myself. That's what God says here in Isaiah. He says, can someone go to a strong man's house and go and deliver what is captured? Can you point a man in his house in the eye and he does not respond? And God is saying, if there's someone who's going to rise there and oppose my mission, I'm going to rise up and come myself in person. Are we together? So your role as an ambassador, when you are joining ministry, whether you are a singer, you are a preacher, there's more at stake than what meets the eye. It is not a spiritual endeavor only. We are involved and engaged in a literal battle that if it is not handled aright, some people will lose their lives forever. So the question that must come to us is, how do we handle? Because we are here to make sure, because the Bible says here we are ambassadors, as if God is appealing to you through us. Then it says here, be reconciled to God. Naturally, we are hostile to God. Now, when you are an ambassador, your government, ne, takes over your life. Are we right? If you must choose between becoming a parliamentarian and being ambassador, I'm advising you now, leave that parliamentarian, become an ambassador. Because when you are an ambassador, government takes your life over. The school fees of your children is paid for. It gives you a home to live in, the cars to drive. Your entire life is engulfed and taken over. And this is what the Bible suggests to us. When Christ says, don't worry what you shall eat, he's saying, if you enlist your services under me, I'm going to take care of yourself. God does not come to share with you in your life. He takes over. Naturally, God is a ruler. He cannot be subjected to anything else apart from that. And when his governance is challenged, he says, it is me who's going to rise up. Naturally, when you are going to war, ne, you must arm yourself. Am I right? You arm yourself. You don't just go to battle and wake up and go to war. part of the things that you get trained at when you go to enlist yourself as a soldier, one of the things they work you psychologically is your in your mind is that they're going to be your friends. Some you might relate with that are going to be shot in front of your eyes. And you will not have time to nurse them. You're going to have to gather strength and jump over a person you are affectionate with because the enemy is still out there. And continue to fight. The challenge of our time is that we have weak Christians who must be nursed. We just say some things about you, you no longer come to church. Who is it that we must talk about if we are not talking about you? We are the one we know. We have not touched you. We did not beat you. We just say some words concerning you, and you now no longer come to church. Friends, we are engaged in a battle. And the Bible says we need to fortify our minds with the truth. You know this thing that says you fortify, Paul will put it in other words and says, seal them. When you seal, you know when they put Christ in the grave, they say they took concrete. Ne? And then they sealed the grave. They put the concrete and closed it. And then they went and took the Roman sign and put it on that cement. And then they put the Roman soldiers there so that now it becomes a governmental affair. Should you tamper with that signature, not the concrete, but what is put on that concrete, the soldiers are here to make sure that you don't undermine their government. When you put God's word in your mind, any opposing force, the Bible says God will command his angel concerning you. So that whatever it is that comes to oppose, first it meets the barricading block before it can come to the signature. God wants to make sure that we are untouchable. Now, I said here, when you go to war, you arm yourself. God is a lion, ne? Of Judah. Maybe to bring it close. And then here, he sends an enemy from heaven. Cast him out, defeat him. And then he comes here. And then he gets here and captures us. And when God comes to deliver us, he disarms himself so that it becomes a fair deal. He disarms himself and comes here as a child to meet a man that left heaven with an envoy of angels. He comes here helpless to the human eye, preparing for battle. Heaven does not fight. That's why Paul says the weapons of our warfare are not what the world uses. We fight a good fight. We don't do things as the world does it. When we go to war, when Jacob is about to face his brother, the Bible says God compromises him. Then he says, now you can go to war. It is his way of dealing with us. When Paul tries to get to him, he says, I was compromised. And God says, my grace is sufficient for you. So we are dealing with a man that is stronger than us, who does not come to us with armor, but he works in our minds. And Paul will say, with these weapons, we conquer every imagination and thought. Anything that the devil suggests, it is at your weakest point that the devil comes. You know, the Bible says the devil tempted Christ in his moment of weakness. Ne? I'm not sure if he thought he could win, but he tried. And then when you read it in Desires of Ages, Ellen White says, he came to Christ at his weakness. At a time, he needed words of encouragement, because a human heart needs sympathy when it is in pain. And then the devil says, well, wonak abu zegub, balele ngap, utema batandas. One of your trusted disciples is selling you as you are kneeling here. Another one is going to leave you in that Pilate's hall. All of them will forsake you. Why don't you just go home and leave them here? At a point, we rightly estimate the cost of our salvation. And Ellen White says, at this point, our salvation hanged in the balance. And Christ pleads with the Father to say, is there no other way that these ones can be saved except for my dying? And Isaiah says, at that point, faith could not present hope to Christ beyond the portals of the grave. Christ went into the grave solely by faith, trusting him who sent him that he will raise him. Friends, that battle that was fought in Calvary at Golgotha, Paul says it continues. He says there's something within us that even when we want to do what is right, which we know is right, but we don't do it. And the bad that we don't want to do, we find ourselves doing it. But we are not without a sympathizing Savior. We have one who was tempted just as we are, yet without sin. Paul will say, he who knew no sin, God made him to be sin for us. When she comments on the life of this woman that they brought and said, we found her doing the things, then they bring her to Christ. Ellen White says, Christ knew the circumstances that shaped her life. What brought her to that point, heaven understood it. Even when she was kneeling before Christ, trembling at that moment, the Bible says Christ could interpret even her very act that was condemned by others. Naturally, we are good people. We want to serve God. We want to please him. When appeals are made here, we are sincere when we rise and respond. But when we leave this place, life meets us and compromises us. Because we have an enemy. Ellen White says the devil has studied us with fudious exactness. Usaran was vuka salpi, ulala kasalpi, ungogola naubani, ngandoni, indono ichayo, oitandayo. He's detailed about your life. So that when he concocts a temptation, he's sure to compromise you and make an enemy of God. So now we are not going to lift arms and face the devil. But the Bible says, resist the devil. He will flee from you. He might have a nice beard, nice voice, good looking. Resist him. Eventually, he's going to flee. Even if he has, she has a nice figure, the dimples are in their place, resist her. Friends, what will it profit us if we head the whole world and lose our lives? You know, there are things that works at a certain point for a moment, but that are not good to hold on to for life. I'm talking to you now, and then I sit down. I think it was Miles Monroe who was talking about the life of Samson. He says, was it Gideon or Samson? One of them, the ones who like to fight. But it was one of them. He says he had to face the Philistines. And there were 1,000 Philistines that were coming to face him. And then he tried to look around him. He could not find anything which he can use to fight. And he found a jaw of an ass. Samson, all right. So he finds this jaw, he fights with it. At the end of the story, there were 1,000 dead Philistine soldiers and a man that is holding a bloodied jaw of a donkey. But then he says he did something that is wonderful. He took that jaw and threw it away. It was okay for a moment. It was anointed to work for that moment and not further. When you are going to war, you don't need to manufacture jaws of donkeys. There are better weapons you can use. They might work at a certain point and give you the victory. One singer that I like says, how can I claim for myself the victories that God has won? We are engaged in a battle that we are said to be fighting when God is conquering on our behalf and through us. And ultimately we'll be crowned as victors, having done nothing much, because all that we have has been given to us, including the victory. That's why the Bible says there's no condemnation for those that are in Christ. Friends, if I must make an appeal, the gospel needs ambassadors. And if you enlist yourself, God is saying, I will take over. I will take charge. I will take care of your needs. But I must be ruler in your life. If God must rule, he must begin with you. He is saying, I'm bringing a kingdom, and I will leave it with none. God cannot be a king and a ruler if he does not have a kingdom. And we are second in command. You know the beauty of salvation. Christ should be the only one who rules with his Father. But he says, I don't call you servants, and call you my brothers. And the Bible says, don't you know that you are going to rule with him? We are called into a kingdom, and God is establishing it. And he is ambassadors. Now, any country, when it operates from a foreign mission or field, it must have its embassy that protects its citizens. Paul says our home is in heaven. And we're here as visitors. And God has placed the church strategically that anyone who belongs there when he sees the flag, will come running, hide himself, and he's safe. And if the church cannot be the safe space for those who come into it, then God's mission is compromised. Bazalan, I'm putting this picture and scenario for us so that we understand our mission in a different light. And how we handle it must be different than how we have viewed it before. Yes, it has a spiritual aspect, but it has a political endeavor. We're here partly on a political assignment to make sure that when the enemy comes, we fight and God would lift the standard. We don't fight alone. We are not without help. When you understand that the war that began in heaven continues to this day, probably it's raging in someone's heart here. You've got battles that you can't even share with friends. And allow me to say to you this morning, the Bible says God will give you the victory. And at the end of it all, we will reign with Christ. But we have a duty. Let us resist the devil. Can we bow our heads and pray? Loving Father in heaven, we are coming before your throne. I want to thank you for this privilege that we can know that because you have saved us and redeemed us. We are looking forward to a day when us, your redeemed, including those that are asleep, will be resurrected. And the resurrected shall be repatriated. And the repatriated shall be coronated. And the coronated shall be inaugurated. In that morning, when your saved ones stand before the seat of glass, we want to be in that number. Oh Lord, may we help each and every one of these, your children, struggling with different kinds of temptations. But our prayer, dear Father, is that you could save us. When you shall come, may you make our election sure. We commit our lives in your care, for we know that whatever it is that we commit in thy care, that you shall keep. For it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. I sing sometimes.